Welcome back to our Digital Marketing Stage live sessions. Hope you had a great break and you are now eager for more insights and strategies on how to improve your businesses. Our next guest is Silvia Dumitrașcu, the highly experienced web performance product lead and functional manager at Digital Tribe, ING Bank Romania, our main partner. As personally, I am a fan of ING's digital innovations, I was really looking forward to this session to find out more about the latest insights on how to make a website even more relevant to our customers and to improve our relationship with them. As Silvia puts it, when building a successful website, it's all about owning a digital space where you can meet as many of your users' needs as possible, an equation where SEO and UX can get you far. Just a quick reminder, please post your questions to the Q&A tab for the session. It's on the right side of your screen. What does your brand need? How can you apply what you've just learned from Silvia? Or maybe you just want some more information on something, write it down. With no further ado, let's go. Silvia?
Thank you, Carmen, for this very nice intro. And hello, everybody. I will start sharing so you will be hearing my voice.
Yep. Well, let's see.
Hope it's okay.
Yes, it's okay. We can see your screen. Perfect.
So today we will tackle one of the main topics of the world of digital experiences we are living in, and that is what makes a website relevant? Well, for our customers, of course. And just want to say that customer experience is a hot topic in itself these days, and for good reason, because, you know, good customer experience does make your users come back again and again. And however, bad customer experience can drive them away at an exponential rate, as bad experiences usually are shared with other people. So you see the social media reactions we get, right? So while keeping this in mind, let's see the agenda for today. We will start by focusing a bit on the functional purposes of a website, so pretty general. And then we will be looking at a few statistics to understand why we should think mobile first and why mobile web is important. And then, spoiler alert, because we will deep dive into the two ingredients that make a website performant. Two acronyms we need to remember, SEO and UX, so search engine optimization and user experience. Then I will be encouraging you to develop a test learn culture to keep that performance up. And we will be wrapping up with a few key takeaways. So without further ado, let's get started. So what is the purpose of a website? You can write down your ideas on the chat or QA if you want, but this brainstorming shouldn't take long. Just think at how many types of websites you know. Are there media or news sites, blogs, wikis, or community sites? E-commerce that are so popular these days, you know, we have Black Friday now, and their objective is to sell, sell, sell. However, when we are talking about the business website, things are more complex. Usually we get to have mixed purposes, and you can see this word cloud clutter here. It doesn't seem to make much sense. However, I can give you the example of ing.ro. We have the purpose of brand building by including brand identifiers that would help us keep a consistent experience across countries because we are an international brand. Educational purpose for customers by including tutorials on how to use the internet banking service because, you know, it's very useful these days. Then informative, we have a dedicated useful information section to customers' updates regarding services, tips and tricks, latest news, even podcast sections. Also, the contact with the customers is very important to connect them with our call center, customer representatives, and the function you may have thought about first. That is, since we are a business, customer acquisition, because, you know, you want your business to grow. So the main message I want you to remember from this slide is functionality comes first, and then you align the design. Because we tend to get seduced by the nice templates that have a modern feel, minimalist. You know, the client usually wants that kind of a website by the way it looks. But we want the website to work, actually. So start with the functionality. And now, why should we think mobile first? Well, let's see a bit of context. in the summer of 2020, that is, you know, really, really recent, we've seen that active internet users are growing, and it's no wonder. So we are about at 4.6 billion active internet users globally. Then, you know, the most accessed channel is mobile to access the internet. We have 91% of those active internet users using mobile. And of course, a really interesting trend that you want to explore is that most of them use social media. So it gives us hints. What I want you to remember, and it's a very key message here, is that the web is an open environment and is the only platform that reaches all of your users. You have great opportunity there to contact them and also, you know, to help you grow, actually, because their needs should be matched to your business services or products. So keep in mind, mobile is very important right now, and we will see what we need to do next to make mobile relevant for us. So what does a great website experience consist of? And I spilled it before, it's about search engine optimization and user experience. These are very important factors. And why should we care about SEO? Because, you know, we kind of get the perception that it's very complex, and it is, but if we want to understand why it's important, let's think a bit about the benefits. So SEO for your website, it actually means visibility. You can call it findability, we can call it accessibility for the users. In general terms, you get found. So by being among the first in those search engine results pages, SERP, you actually get the chance to meet the needs of the users with the ones of your services and products for your business. And that traffic that becomes an opportunity for you, you can convert it and then grow your business. And we also have a few facts that really enforce the idea of SEO being important. And those are 93% of users won't go past the first page of Google. Uh-oh, this is an uh-oh moment. And what does this mean? It means, you know, we have to stick by the SEO rules. We need to be present there. Then on the first page alone, the first five organic results account for almost 68% of all the clicks. This actually means we need to be SEO champs to be among the first five on the first page, right? And on top of them all, we have Google search algorithm that uses more than 200 factors to rank websites. Well, you know, this is a big deal. It sounds very complex. However, and usually we get the perception that whenever Google at least changes their algorithm, it's kind of like a mystery. It's a secret recipe there, you know? You need to know it if you can do anything. So you're in the middle of the unknown desert. But luckily, we do have SEO experts who are giving us hint of what is important. And also Google is helping us out. And I'll give you one of the most important factors these days. So Google researched and they showed that mobile searches have a higher buyer intent. This means that people who are doing a search on a laptop or desktop are more inclined to buy than users. Actually, users doing a search on mobile are more inclined to buy compared to users doing a search on desktop. So it sounds like those are the users, the mobile ones, you want to target, right? And actually what Google did in 2019, they switched to the mobile first index. It means that when you're doing a search on laptop or desktop, the results are based on Google's index of the mobile versions of websites. And if you want to convert those mobile searches, you need to be sure your site is responsive and visible when mobile users are searching. So, you know, it's a big opportunity there for the mobile searches. They convert faster and there are big volumes, but we need to be present. And I'll start with the basics of what we can do, because without covering the basics, you know, these are the holy grails of SEO. It's much more complex these days. However, just start by doing them and afterwards you can grow. It's incremental growth in your strategy. So first, you provide. So the ones that are relevant for the customers. And you do that, you know, there are many tools online. I think there are over 100. Search Console I would recommend because you have more data there. But use whatever you think it's useful and easy for you. Then we have the Holy Grail, meta title, meta description, H1 tag. With the meta description, I just have one request. Don't cram all the keywords you find there because users see them on the search engine results. And, you know, they need to be human. Express humanly to seduce the user. Tell them why they should visit your site, right? So it's a good opportunity to make up a nice human human description. Then sitemap and robots.txt files. Those are guiding crawlers on, you know, what to index on your website and what's relevant. So there are tools, again, you can use to generate them, but do the maintenance. So all these things need maintenance. I'm not telling you it is hard work, however, it does pay off. And I cannot go through SEO without telling you a bit about my favorite indexing factor, and that's page load speed. Because when customers come to your site, you only have actually milliseconds, not seconds, to influence them. On mobile, at least, they expect the page to load instantly. And if we look at the global average time it takes to fully load a mobile page, well, it's more than 15 seconds. So there is a difference. However, we don't need to panic because Google will not penalize us in searches if our page loads in a few seconds. That's pretty much okay. But in case our site is very slow, you don't receive the traffic from the searches. And, you know, if SEO is not an argument to take care of the load speed, then maybe knowing that with page speed, with a good page speed, it will help you convert more customers. You know, it will give you a hint. And then just to tell you an example, when you're browsing sites on your phone, there's nothing worse than going to a site that loads so slowly, you feel like you're gonna bounce, right? So users bounce if their page doesn't load fast enough. So take this and keep it in mind, because page speed is not only as an indexing factor Google introduced in their algorithm, it's also about user experience. And user experience, good timing, because we reached our second ingredient. Why would user experience matter for your users? Well, you know, we are all investing in media campaigns, nice marketing campaigns, because we want high volumes of traffic to reach our pages and our websites. But the truth is that ads are only as effective as the website they direct traffic to. So what does this mean? It means that once a user has a bad experience on a website, you have very, very low chances they will come back again. However, when a user has a good experience and you have a well-designed user interface and a nice website, you will get them returning, and actually they will be loyal customers on the long term. So keep this in mind. User experience, you know, it pays off, it makes a difference. And also, this is a no-pressure message. We are competing with the best experience a consumer has ever had. Because in this world of digital experiences, customers actually expect from us to tell them what they need well before they realize it themselves. So, you know, it kind of sounds like Mission Impossible, but it can be done. I encourage you. Because it will, you know, you will build a love brand at the end if you manage to do that. And now, let's get to the, you know, concrete stuff. So what do we need to do so that we have, you know, a good UX on the website? Well, as a general message or rule, you can keep in mind what I advise you to do is to stop doing the annoying things that annoy you when you visit mobile sites. This is the main message I can tell you. And I put a list here, and you can do it yourself, of course, of things that annoy me on mobile sites, but they, luckily, these ones have quick fixes. However, just keep them in mind. You know, it's that easy to be empathetic with the client. And also, another thing, you know, what you don't want to do to your customers is like send them to an eye exam that is really painful and make them read the last two lines on this table in my right, the row 10 and 11, because it's so difficult to read, right? So what we need to do as a basic, just give them the clear and easy information they can find. So let's see what I found. Make sure clickable area is large enough for finger taps. Oh yes, please do that. Because I usually find on mobile sites that I cannot click on them. You know, my finger doesn't reach the link. So I'm stuck and I want to find that information and I want to convert, but you know, I really can't. And it's really not easy. I decide to scroll and bounce. So, you know, we can do a quick fix on that one. Then, contact, phone number, click to call link. You really don't want to make me copy paste in my keypad and then call you. If I'm on a mobile phone, it's easy to just click and it will be connected to my contacts. So please, please put a link behind the contact phone number. Then, mobile menu. It should be, of course, easy to navigate because we don't want to find ourselves in the Hansel and Gretel story where we are looking for breadcrumbs, right? We want to guide the users through the pages exactly when we want them to convert. So, you know, it's win-win in this case. Another important thing is forms. If you have lead forms, make them easy to use because I'm a customer. I really want to give you my personal data. So it's a big thing for me in general. But, you know, if I don't know in what format I should insert those that information in the fields, it would be hard at the end. So make them easy to use because they want to give you their data, right? Then font size, you know, you've seen the eye exam example. Don't give me rows 10 and 11. Don't squeeze that content on a smaller screen as we are used to desktop content. Do it for mobile. Think mobile first. The screen is smaller. Give me less text with more value. And then images. Images help you in two ways. So you don't want me to use that huge desktop image. You want me to use an image that fits my small mobile screen and that will make me at the end of the day load the page faster because huge images from desktop actually slow down your site. So keep that in mind and use, you know, the nice images dedicated for mobile devices. And now that we are done with the UX and the SEO, it's been pretty complex there, we can relax a bit and think about data. What I encourage you to do, it sounds pretty pompous and big to build a test and learn culture, but actually it's about building a behavior, something that you can do frequently. That will help you take the right decisions based on data. So, what I advise you to do is not do the big changes, the redesigns, anything you want to change in your page. Don't rush to do them. Don't rush into commitment. Test them before. So these examples you are looking at are very, very popular. There are very small things you can do that you will see they change the conversion rate on a page, they change the time users spent on a page, also the click-through rate. However, you need to test them because something you have the perception to know that works, after a quantitative or qualitative test done on users, you may be surprised to find out it doesn't really, and you may have, you know, your conversion rate drop, then grow. So, quick things you can do. And Google also advises, because they're also into user experience and what works in terms of conversions. Test the text you put on the call to action button. A different text may have, you know, different results. Test the colors, also colors. We tend to be influenced by visual stimuli more these days than in the past. So test the colors. Then, static carousel. Carousel is a big component usually found on home pages. Test static versus slider to see if the dynamic works, if the user is more inclined to click on secondary banners, and also animations versus static content again, see if that makes a difference, but with the objective to convert on the page. It depends actually on the purpose. We mentioned a few at the beginning you have on that page. So do the A-B tests, do the experiments, do the research, do the usability test. If you have UX, if you have agencies, you can do them yourselves as well, because that's how you get data. And that's how, when you get data, you learn. You will know the right decision the next time you need to take a decision regarding your site. So keep in mind, don't rush into commitment. Really test beforehand. Whoa, and we actually pretty fast, we reached the wrapping up section and the key takeaways, and it seemed like a lot, I know. However, I'll keep it really, really short, because the message I want to tell you today is that you should invest in what really matters. And what we learned is that mobile web matters. We know that people are using mobile all the time. It's about convenience. You have the smartphone integrated in your life 24/7. So, mobile first, right? Then SEO. SEO gets you found. So, take care of the basics and go follow the SEO rules. User experience. People come to you because you have good UX and they stay. So, it's very good to keep your nice user interface well at hand, and also test things. Use research, use user testing. Data is power, we know the phrase. And data, you will be the only one knowing in detail what the website is about. You're the one who has the knowledge, better than your competitors, of course, and better than anyone else. So you take the right decisions. Tools. Tools are our friends. We are digital. Tools help us get, you know, fast, let's say fast results, actually more fast. We are more fast in taking decisions while having the right data. So that's why I encourage you to use tools, and many are free, so you can use them. And, well, I cannot wrap up without telling you, you know, a message at the end of the day related to the context we are in. So this year has shown how important it is to be customer centric. So we are feeling the importance of finance. It's everywhere, right? We also help to keep customers safe by empowering them to do their banking and payments at a distance with digital and contactless solutions. And websites are part of the digital experience. They have huge reach. And if your culture is customer centric, you will get a win-win for your business and customers at the end of the day. So, you know, customers feel when you care about them, and at the end of the day, you will grow your business. So on behalf of the search engine bots and myself, I just need to say, take care, be safe, and, you know, do your thing. And I think we can open for QA.
Yes, perfect. Thank you very much, Silvia. It was very to the point, very useful, and at the same time, a fun presentation. So thanks a lot for that. We have one question, just a moment, regarding the KPIs. So the question would be, which are the most important KPIs through which we can measure the performance of a website?
Well, sure, you have many, and I encourage you to use a funnel like, you know, KPI list, because you need to look at your website from the beginning, from the moment in which you attract the customers. It's like visits, right? Then you can go to the returning visitors because you want to see the quality of the traffic. Then you should look as well to the number of click-through, so the click-through rate in the site. Then the leads, if you have lead forms and you want to see acquisition. But of course, maybe you're not able to measure sales end-to-end if you don't have an end-to-end flow in your site. But at the end of the day, sales does matter. So, you know, you get traffic. Does it convert to leads? And then does it convert to sales? So do the calculate between them and see the rates between them. And, you know, if you have a content website, so it depends all what you have on the page, you will be interested in how much time people spend on the page, the readability, the bounce rate. So, you know, you should align from the beginning on the purpose and see functionally what you want to achieve.
Great. Thank you. And sorry, you wanted to say something else.
Welcome. You're welcome.
I actually have two comments that kind of build up on what you have just presented. It's regarding the fact that the user experience is sometimes damaged by the fact that companies optimize too much for crawlers, and so they don't take into account user experience. And another one saying that jumping text and pages can also be very annoying, because websites use it to try to optimize, but it's actually damaging the user experience. So if you have any thoughts on that.
Yeah, you know, as I mentioned, we tend to cram up so many keywords in a page because we believe that, you know, the volume matters. However, we should think beside it, because I'll just tell you a hint. Google's algorithm isn't about necessarily the volume of keywords. It's also about it's AI, for starters. It's called Rank Brain. It's been for a couple of years and it's learning. So what matters most now is actually user experience. So if you don't have those pages readable for the user and accessible, they won't rank you well. So yeah. They are using AI because they want to feel human, to see what the human feel is from a mobile perspective right now, and we'll see in the future. And the idea is that I mean, you're right, you shouldn't use tactics that, you know, you believe work, but actually they're not integrated in the context. So I would rather in your shoes, I would rather just take a colleague, and ask them to read and see if they are interested in them, because traffic that's attractive to your site will bring more traffic, and it won't be artificial. We are not artificially optimizing the sites. We should be humanly optimizing the sites.
And this brings us to our next question. Is there such a thing as too much optimization? Should you sometimes trade load times for user experience?
They actually go together very well.
There's no easy answer to that, right?
Yeah, because no user will get upset if you load their page, you know, very fast. So I think the right question in this case is, should we trade creativity versus a faster load page? Because usually, so you want to use animations, you want to use nice elements that maybe they're, you know, heavy on the load of the page. The idea is to go midway, and maybe you can test them, because maybe that animation that is a bit larger, you can also optimize in terms of creative sizes, for sure. That works better, keeps the user to read your material. So just test it beforehand, and then you will know if it works or not.
Yeah, that makes sense. And we have time for one more very quick question. How important are the backlinks when it comes to SEO in 2020? And what white hat techniques should we use when it comes to generating backlinks?
Well, backlinks are very important, because what do they mean? They actually tell the crawlers and the algorithm that people are interested in your site, right? So they bring you traffic. I would say, as whitehead, because we are kind of shy when we talk about black tactics and white tags, they're kind of, you know, tricking the system, the idea. User PR. Use PR, because you know, when you have articles that are put on other sites because they bring traffic to your site, they generate traffic, and it's an easy way to bring them to yours. So
thank you very much. Yes.
You're welcome. Thanks. Bye.
It was very nice. Thank you, everybody, and see you in the next session quite in a bit. Thanks. Bye.